When you look at soaps, what you see are the bones of other shows in terms of very basic principles of good and evil.
Daytime is the foundation of everybody wants that bad guy.
Back in the day, it was like must-see TV.
There are elements of soap opera in every dramatic television show that's ever been produced.
Every primetime drama, every reality show.
I'm also really drunk.
It's all a soap opera.
My own Breaking Bad was a soap opera.
You're right.
That's kind of remarkable.
Soap opera writers are smart. They know how to hook you into the characters and what's going on.
It's a magic formula, truly addictive.
I love General Hospital. I haven't missed a day in a whole year.
You can just escape.
I watch soap operas because they make my problems look very small.
Have endured because they make money, a lot of money.
Soap operas hit a pulse nobody really knew was there.
The story of soaps goes back as far as early radio.
You dare to talk to me like that, you love thief?
A show that's been on in people's living rooms for almost 57 years.
I want to be special, and I'm going to be.
That's longer than most marriages.
Right from the get-go, this was groundbreaking.
Soaps got their storylines ripped from the headlines.
A gay.
Racism, abortion, rape.
I'm your husband! What is this don't touch me stuff?
Subject matters other people didn't really want to tackle.
Are you taking birth control?
They deserve more respect, for sure.
It was an industry that was for women and by women, and you just hadn't seen that before. But the bubble had to burst.
Down a little bit with the cards, yeah. And starting right on the lens. Okay, should be in one position.
I think there are those derisive comments made about soap operas.
Round number.
And it's not fair and it's not accurate. You're there to learn. You're there to try to bring as much reality and honesty as you can to the moment. And it's difficult. I was 25 years old when I got the job in Loving and moved from Los Angeles to New York. It felt like I crossed a threshold. This genre, this job, invited me in and put me to work like nobody's business.
Rolling sound, quiet.
Well, my two favorite women in the world.
Whoa.
Hi, Mom.
Oh, hey.
It made me feel accomplished, like I broke through a barrier.
There was this stigma to daytime and people misperceiving the acting style as over the top or what was called soapy. But I always say, if you can do daytime, you can do any time.
Oscar goes to Brad Pitt.
Morgan Freeman.
Tommy Lee Jones.
Julianne Moore still out.
Is this happening? Can this be happening?
Daytime television has opened the doors to many, many successful and talented actors.
Hey, Michael
Crittan.
Julianne Moore started in soaps. The great Kelly Ripa started in soaps.
I killed my own mother.
Meg Ryan, Demi Moore.
How do you do that?
Brad Pitt.
It was one of the best jobs an actor can have.
All right, Mama, don't worry. I'll be sure.
Lily Mae Clemens.
Yes, I'm Mrs. Clemens.
Well, then you would be my aunt.
I went out to Los Angeles and got cast on Knots Landing.
Well, I'm sorry I didn't call first. This was sort of a spur of the moment thing.
It was probably one of the five most important times of my life. They had a very good cast. They had a very talented cast. And of course, that changes everything when you go to work. You don't care if it's a soap, if you're working with somebody who's great, everything goes up. I loved it.
Days of Our Lives was my very first job as an actress on camera. And I was green, but very happy and with a really big weave. The 80s was all about big hair, honey. I was a nurse, but my weave was banging, okay?
What's going down, Pop?
I was working at my dad's restaurant, and I was just barely not a virgin. I just Monday shot the first episode on a Wednesday, and it aired a week later.
Blackie and the Ripper!
People say, oh, it's a good learning, a great training ground, and I think some soap actors would think that's insulting, and maybe it is, but it was great training.
Okay, will you go to opening positions, folks, please?
No.
I learned so much. I learned how to hit my cue, how to memorize, how to cry, how to do a hair toss.
You are forced to really think on your feet, follow your instincts, know your lines.
And I've been there with you.
And I've been there beside you.
We work, as you know, in television, very strenuous hours. I mean, 12, 14, 16, 22 hours a day, 8 to 60 pages of dialogue a day. I mean, he was gracious.
Every time I get my scripts, I always think, how am I going to memorize all this? And somehow I do.
Scripts are stashed everywhere.
Raise your armpit, honey, so I can read my line. Thank you.
Stand by.
Are you?
I auditioned for quite a few soap operas when I was coming up. And it's a lot of work. You know, you have to memorize page upon page upon page of lines, and that moves at breakneck pace because it airs five times a week.
This is like a typical day here at All My Children. There are 47 scenes today. That's insane.
You grab the gun thusly, right?
We had one lovely, lovely Hollywood actor who had a total breakdown during dress rehearsal one day and said, I can't do this, you have to let me go. And they did, they released it. Because he said, it's insane to do this much work in one day. We loved it.
5 seconds.
If you can handle this, you can handle anything.
Hats off to him, for sure. Because I've had a few weeks on Mad Men where I had all of the lines and I was in every scene. And we were shooting one episode every 10 days.
Upstage corridor.
We shoot about 120 pages a day. A movie is 120 pages. We move fast. It's intense. It's very demanding. It looks easy when you see it, but all of the production elements that go into it, the acting, the writing, the directing, the producing, the lighting, the hair, the makeup, we're putting on a movie every day.
That condition really tests a performer to be able to look every single day at ways that you can bring honesty and reality to that character in those scenes.
Why do I do this? Why do I put myself through this? Because I love to tell stories. I love it. I like to take people on that ride. And if I get a good story, it's really fun to act it.
Daytime can offer a great environment, a playground, if you will, to expand yourself and stretch your skills. See how far you're willing to go.
It's our job to sell it for you, and that's really what it comes down to. And it's a soap opera, so it's like being a kid in a candy store. There's nothing you can't do or don't do.
You were married to me and sleeping with my brother.
Have you lost your mind?
The most deliciously wonderful thing about daytime drama is that there are literally no rules.
Where's my baby?
Kevin was kidnapped. Jessica was kidnapped.
And you didn't do anything to help her?
That's kind of standard daytime fare.
How dare you show your reconstructed face around here?
My character was having sex with an alien from outer space.
We could have done it together.
Oh, yeah, you're possessed by the devil.
I command you to release her, Espiriti.
Man, I could get used to this.
Sex, lies,
murder, and assorted mayhem.
Evil twins.
Why do you look like me? Who are you?
Reva? You got that right. Ow!
Oh! You broke my mother's heart, you little...
Ooh. That's how you get the audience to keep coming back, is to have a storyline that just jumps out at you, grabs you, and pulls you back in.
Stupid ass!
Oh. Soap opera doesn't get a lot of respect for that, but it should.
It's a match made in Soapland, and the only people happier than the happy couple were the advertisers.
One in 15 Americans is said to watch this show.
Daytime drama created serialized television, which we certainly embrace and love now.
When people think about soaps, they think about daytime, but that's not the whole story.
O.J. Simpson.
There was no greater soap opera in the world than O.J.
That, to me, has always been the birth of true reality television.
I am from Chicago!
Soaps became kind of unnecessary because you could do it with real people, and they're writing the drama themselves.
It's a craft, creating a reality show that can out-soap the soaps.
Plenty of bad things happen in these halls every day, but there is always something good waiting just around the corner.
Well, I thought that you could use one of these.
My little, I know.
We rise together and we fall together.
It all comes down to family.
Thank God for General Hospital.
Yes, you're here.
Thank God.
General Hospital, weekdays on ABC.
The story of soaps.
Well, it's quite a story, the story of television. The entire world began to pour into American homes.
Most criticized of any type of program on the air today is the soap opera.
55% of women in America watch soap operas.
So are the days of our...
5 seconds, 4, 3, 2...
My girlfriends and I would come home after school, and you're in middle school, you're not quite an adult, you still have crushes, but you don't have a boyfriend yet. And we would live vicariously through what was happening on Guiding Light.
Each day, 35 million Americans tune in to watch their favorite soap.
Once you start, you can't stop. You get into the stars. And
they keep you intrigued.
It takes a while out of washing dishes.
My grandmother, my dear, sweet grandmother, got everyone in her nursing home to watch. And they were all glued all the time.
It is a fantasy, let's face it. I think everybody has to have a fantasy.
I've even got my husband character. Hooked on the Young and Restless.
I have a routine. Every night I come home and watch it in my own little living room with my own little TV, my own little daughter eating her own little dinner.
My mom watched all the ABC shows, so she was like Ryan's Hope, All My Children, When I Lived General Hospital. And then my grandmother was a CBS daytime person.
We're family.
So she turned me on to Young and the Restless. So by the time I was on my own, I was watching, you know, all of these shows.
Daytime dramas have been literally in the homes of millions of people for decades. And like traditions, it's passed down from generation to generation.
The only other place you have that is sports. When you think about sports fandom, most of the time you're thinking about fathers introducing their sons to the love of their sports team. Women's and girls' equivalent were soap operas.
Rose, every mother knows that her child is perfect.
Dr. Malone.
Oh, I know how anxious you are for us to have a family.
A man or beast.
Ah. In the early 1930s, when the giant American soap companies wanted a vehicle to advertise their products to a vast, a regular, and a captive audience, they chose a daytime radio serial.
Vampire.
Sales increased, and the soap opera was born.
Wait, bald man, how can I thank you?
Don't thank me.
Advertising is largely marketed towards women.
Wonderful campaign.
And if you wanted to catch a lot of women, you wanted to catch them in the daytime. Not in the evenings when their husbands were home from work, when their kids were home from school, when it was time to get dinner on the table. If you wanted to influence their decisions about what kind of detergent they bought, what kind of cleaning products they used, what kind of chicken they bought, daytime was the time to grab them.
You don't know, Mater,
that at this very moment, Ted is in conference with his attorney regarding a divorce.
Serialized shows invented a new kind of storytelling where there was a beginning, a middle, and there was no end. It just kept on going.
Don't miss tomorrow's chapter.
The cliffhanger on every episode was essential.
And once you're there, you're hooked.
You're talking to a woman who'd rather see you dead before she can trust a small boy into your care. I'd kill you, sister.
The amount of money that these shows were able to generate because advertisers wanted to get on board became really significant really quickly. These were money-making shows.
And didn't I see a pie in the oven?
Mm-hmm. I put a Crisco apple pie in along with my rose.
And the way to engage that audience was to create content that spoke specifically to women's issues.
Surprise, surprise. The people that knew how to tell stories for women happened to be women.
And now, the guiding light. Created by Erna Phillips.
If there's a doyen or queen of soap operas, it would be Erna Phillips.
She took that formula of the radio and put it on television, but took it one step further.
She created so many elements that we now still use.
Orson Welles is the boy wonder of radio and film. Erna Phillips is the girl wonder of radio and television.
I've been asked to tell you about television.
Another post-war wonder.
Larger and more lifelike.
It was a noisy, sputtering gadget.
She found a specific aesthetic for this new medium of television in the 1950s.
And a new industry called broadcasting.
She said the camera should linger on moments of tension between characters.
Until you interfered in the San Diego situation.
On a character as their emotions are unfolding on their face. She also said, I want a lot of close-ups. Close-up, close-up, close-up. Oh my God. That's what creates these long, drawn-out, tense shots.
Don't be a fool.
That are constitutive of soap operas. She created a way of shooting and editing daily television that drew viewers in. That made people sit up and say, oh, this is what television can do.
Erna Phillips tutored Agnes, who took it even further when her show started to hit the air in the 60s.
It was the time when teenagers let their hair grow to
the Negro still.
Hemline zoomed up.
Is not free.
You may not know Agnes Nixon by name, but you most definitely know her work. She's made soap operas what they are
soap
today.
Soap opera is increasingly turning to the real world for some of the more serious contemporary problems.
President Kennedy has been shot in Dallas, Texas.
What hope is there for democracy?
Agnes Nixon figured out that soap operas could be more than just housewives talking about their problems over a cup of coffee. All My Children really started to tackle social issues.
P&G and CBS said, no way. This is an entertainment program. I felt they were underestimating women's intelligence, which indeed I think they were.
Up on one.
With the theme, Stand Firm America.
Daytime is classically qualified to do topical stories. We produce at least a show every day, and we can change directions of that story.
The soaps got their storylines ripped from the headlines.
You talk about it like she's some inanimate object.
Agnes Nixon gave you the stories that were around her. Not because she thought they were outrageous, but because she thought they were ordinary.
Demonstrators protest U.S. involvement in the Vietnam War.
When I first started watching, she was writing the story about the Vietnam War. She had one character who was for the war and one character who was against the war, and ultimately a young man who was drafted. It was right around the time we were all marching in Washington. I couldn't believe this was on a soap opera.
Rock Steady by Exclusive.
Television is so different because, you know, when you have success in television, it sticks to people.
on the best level. The soaps mirrored what was going on, not only in the culture, but in women's lives in particular.
You've just got to believe.
Soap operas made television come alive for millions and millions of American women.
And you're gonna be just fine.
Who shot JR?
When the networks were the only game in town, they could make whatever they wanted, and they took a lot of big swings.
Tonight's episode will be a tough act to follow.
Nighttime was the new daytime, and audiences were watching by the millions.
The story of soaps.
Years ago, my husband and I were going to take a month off and go to Europe. I asked a friend of mine, would you send me a telegram every Friday recapping what happened in the week that I'm missing all my children? Now we're in Lake Como and we had some friends there and we got there kind of late. And around 2 o'clock in the morning, there was a knock on the door and standing there was the manager of the hotel with a telegram, and it was kind of shaking. And the telegram said, Erica was kidnapped and has been found in a coma. Mark slipped again and ran away from rehab. He hasn't been found. Mona has to have exploratory surgery. Doesn't look good. Chuck has learned that Donna, who was carrying his baby, was once a hooker. Donna's husband, Palmer, is still in the dark. The woman posing as Brooke's mother is wanted by the police. Phoebe is back on the bottle. Hope you're having a great trip. Well, I started to laugh so hard, I was crying. And they thought I was hysterical. And my friend said, I'm going to give you a Valium. What's the matter? And I'm screaming. I'm laughing so hard. And my husband said, oh, for Lord's sake, that's her soap.
This is what fans do. We sit here every day and watch the show. We eat, we talk, we yell, we laugh, and I cry.
I'm so glad he's back.
We hate certain characters. We love certain characters. We fear certain characters. And it's almost like your own family.
I don't know who that man really is.
Yes, you do.
She does?
He was a boyfriend.
There is no end. There's always another day, another day. Like our hearts beat. Continues. It's a story.
Oh, they didn't see? Oh, my gosh.
Was this mysterious?
I used to be a Hollywood reporter for all of the Hollywood movie magazines. And I had an editor who said to me, listen, I think we should do soap operas. And I set up an interview on As the World Turns. In comes this woman wearing a white furry thing wrapped around her blonde hair, dark big glasses. Hello, darling. And I said, oh my God, this isn't so bad. Here is Miss Lucci and I. This was in Florida. In 1977, my husband and I did our very first soap opera festival. And there were hundreds of thousands of people who came to see the soap opera stars. And that was the beginning of my love affair with soap operas.
My God, I need a strong man. How are you all today? Don't say hot.
Joyce Becker, soap opera festival.
Look at this cookie, like I didn't call you two. Oh, my dear.
Down, girls, down.
The most loyal fans in the world are soap opera fans.
It's just a little addictive.
I haven't missed a day in a whole year.
Even if the show's not good, they think it's great. That's just the way it works.
Give all the soap stars of Guiding Light a New York Liberty Welcome!
Do you think there's such thing as soap addiction?
Oh, no question about it.
And when the soap stars hit the road, their fans come a-running.
We come and visit anywhere around the country, and they show up in masses.
Oh my God, there's Eric Brady.
I really love him. He's so sexy and good looking.
How has life changed since you've started on
Well,
Gerald Hoffman?
I sign more autographs now, I guess.
Girls were chasing me down the street. I was a teen idol, and I just loved it.
45 million Americans watch soap operas every day.
If you love the soap, now you can buy the doll.
We made a deal with the Home Shopping Network called Shop the Soaps.
Selling products from storylines directly to the viewer.
Any way that you could layer that emotional connection just made the ratings higher.
Yes, I'm hooked. I have to see them from day to day, even though I know they're not going very far.
The wife has them on the afternoon. I can't say I don't watch them.
I watch them down in the restaurant.
You do?
Yeah, well.
People will feel that daytime is just for women, but it's also men.
The most heavenly letters I get are from the college guys.
Hey.
This gentleman came up to me and he said, I just have to tell you that my wife watches the show and I don't watch it. I don't watch it. And he's kind of like looking, like not really looking at me and then looking away. And but at the very end, he said, so I just have to ask, you know, are you hopeful, Princess Gina? I said, it's our secret, okay? He goes, no, I don't watch. I'm just walking through the room. It's okay. No worries. See you Monday.
Soap opera has given rise to a brand new phenomenon, the soap super character. Not just superstar, super character. Tony Geary is used to playing second fiddle to Luke. When he meets his public, he goes as Luke. It's Luke the fans know, Luke they come to see.
Some fans have difficulty in determining who's standing in front of me. Is it Nikki or is it Melody?
I call it Schizosophia Nervosa.
I would like to meet Raven Swift.
I would be puzzled as to why people were not very nice to me. And then I realized that they thought that I was going to steal their husband.
They're with us every single day, and people really get wrapped up in your story.
Are you going to be getting married this year?
Did you ever get that child?
No, she wouldn't.
Oh, she don't like that one. But Kim, she left that baby alone.
It's more than just seeing somebody you watch on television. There is an emotional involvement there.
Women who watch this particular character would like their husband to be like a Jeremy, their son to be like a Jeremy, their father to be like a Jeremy.
Is your husband around? Can we talk after the show then?
I mean, it's like our own life. I mean, really, I know more about them than I know about myself.
Daytime TV and TV in general, you have a different relationship with the audience because they see you all the time. You had to go somewhere and buy a ticket and watch a movie. And television were people that were in your living room.
It's a beautiful little girl, and she needs us.
The people that watch our shows know us for 10 and 20 and 30 years and 40 years, sometimes even longer. We've grown together and we've aged together.
I loved being your father.
It's history. We're in their room every day, and we become like family.
I was pregnant, and I had a baby on the show. And they all write in, they say, it's Victor's child. Because I have not known this for a long time. So they're very anxious for me to find that out.
I was pregnant with my oldest daughter, not married. In 1981, this was huge news. Do you know that I had thousands of Young and Restless fans send me baby gifts to the studio? I didn't get one negative letter, which is astounding when I think back. My character was certainly not perfect and still is not, but there was something about her. I think she was always very vulnerable. So they always felt very protective of her, and therefore of me.
First of all, I loved playing Erica Kane. Just loved playing her. I started playing Erica in 1970 when all my children began. It was 41 years. There was such range within her, and she was capable of just about doing or saying anything. And I think the audience saw humanity in her stories.
I don't want to be down anywhere with the rest of you. I want to be special, and I'm going to be.
The streak is over, Susan Lucci!
Fans identified with Erica so much and continue to love her.
I'm going back to that studio on Monday, and I'm going to play Erica Kane for all she's worth.
One song, young lady. If you promise not to give me any more arguments, I promise.
Does Mary Stewart and Joe ever mix into one?
I hope we're not separated. It's hard to tell. You know, the joke is we look a lot alike.
Because we're 250 episodes a year, an actor who's on the show for a while has the possibility of really going on a character arc and a journey that is specific to daytime and no other medium.
With soaps, you can grow with a character over decades, even across castings. There's really so few genres across entertainment that can give you the sense of a person as though that person is real.
You're talking about a degree of intimacy and a kind of coexistence with characters that only this medium of television can do.
I can't believe this is you.
I love you every day.
All I am is a mother without a child.
The foundation of any good story has been relativity. Is there a bond there? And if the audience feels that, then you can take those characters and have them go off and be daring, be stupid, be enlightened, and we'll follow you.
I do not need a man to be happy.
You certainly married enough of him.
When a show goes on decade after decade after decade, you want to take some chances.
The story of soaps.
Yeah, start down there. That's good. Okay. Cue the action.
Is this where you want ad-libby stuff? Okay.
The ad-libby stuff. Right, the ad-libby stuff.
So while we kiss, and it's kissing.
One big criticism of soap operas is that there's too much sex, too many torrid affairs.
Makes soap operas boil.
Love and romance, and also more sex.
Everyone sleeps with each other on soaps, that's for sure.
I don't know how they got away with the sexual scenes, actually. There were some pretty hot scenes.
Jackie Smith, who's the head of daytime at ABC, realized that women also like to watch strong men and handsome men, men that women would want to go to bed with.
Yeah. Romantic, huh?
Well, I guess this is good night.
Yeah, I guess so.
The will they or won't they can go on for decades.
It's this quandary where you tune in every week. Are they going to kiss this time? Are they going to fight this time? What's going to happen?
I just want to remind you how much I love you.
No matter how much we pull them apart, we still fight and cheer to watch them come back together.
I loved Jenny and Greg. They were my absolute number one favorite couple.
We may not come from the same backgrounds, but we share important things, like feelings.
It seemed like everybody was against Jenny and Greg. And then when they finally got together, she got blown up on that jet ski. And I'm like, what?
There was such an audience for these characters and their stories that people could really relate to and even just escape with.
Everybody wants the romance. Everybody wants that super couple to cheer for her.
You mean Laura Weber Baldwin wants to wait tables?
Anything wrong with it?
No. There's a lot right with it from where I'm standing.
You can't talk about a super couple without talking about Luke and Laura.
Luke and Laura were the biggest couple in all of daytime history. I was never really big on them. I was like, okay, Luke?
Luke's a street smart disco king, outwardly tough, but tender inside.
I have to have his autograph here.
Be still, my heart.
Luke and Laura may be the most popular daytime TV couple in history.
They were so popular that Elizabeth Taylor wanted to be on General Hospital to play Helena Cassidyne, a huge part of their storyline.
That's a super couple. It's just magic.
Well, on November the 17th, it's finally going to happen, folks. Luke and Laura, those sweethearts from the General Hospital soap opera, are tying the knot.
It was such a big deal in the media, and it took the country by storm.
Why are you crying?
I love Toby and Jeannie. They're the best.
It was the right storyline, the right actors, and the right moment in time to create something that will go down in history as the greatest wedding ever. No offense to the royals.
Fans all across the country watched for the big moment. To them, it was their wedding.
I, Laura Weber Baldwin, take thee, Lucas Lorenzo Spencer.
For a very, very, very long time, more people watched Luke and Laura's wedding than just about any other thing on television.
But he raped her, right? I guess that's what happened. I mean, let's just get to the reality of it.
It's an unconventional romance, and I know that last summer there was a very controversial scene. Why did the show do it?
I've had to justify it for so many years, and I have to say, it feels good to sit here and say, I won't justify it. It's awful. They shouldn't have done it.
Look, I have to go now.
Gloria Monty, the executive producer of General Hospital, essentially was told she had 2 weeks to save the show, and ABC was going to cancel it if she couldn't bring ratings up in that time. In Luke and Laura, she saw potential there to maybe make things happen that shouldn't happen, and that was electric.
Gloria Monty tried to deal with it by calling it rape seduction. The term now would be date rape.
Look, I have to go now.
The night of the rape, Luke's last request was to dance with him. And the dance became very seductive. He took her down to the floor.
Oh, Luke, let me go.
And that is the rape.
No! No, Luke, no!
I don't know how much we had discussed, like, rape at that time, especially on television.
Then the question became, why did Luke do that? And the answer the show's writers gave was that Luke did it from love.
Luke and Laura was a cultural phenomenon. The audience fell in love with them, and they fell in love with the characters, and they bought the idea that true love could come out even of something brutal and horrible.
I'm in love with you.
No, I don't think it's really love, Luke.
Oh, yes. Yes, that's what it is.
They became popular not despite the rape, but partly because of it.
You have to look back on that stuff, and that seems particularly egregious, especially since women were the primary consumers of soap operas during the day. That message was pretty detrimental, and that, well, they got married in the end, so isn't that great? But at the same time, it was entertainment.
You're the only one good thing that I ever had in my life. And I'm really sorry that I hurt you, because I didn't mean to do that.
Like human beings, writers and producers of these shows will make mistakes. The important thing is to identify when a mistake was made and how to rectify it quickly.
Before movements like Me Too, almost 20 years after the rape happened, General Hospital, for months, for almost the whole year, addressed rape head-on in a whole new way. And for the first time, Laura confronted him about having assaulted her.
But seeing this girl, Elizabeth, made me realize that you did hurt me. And it made me remember how badly. I had no idea that could be so brutal. How could you do that to me? How could you say that you loved me and call me your angel and then rape me?
was remarkable to say to Americans, we were wrong. And to, in essence, allow Luke and Laura to finally confront head on something that had been repressed, not just in their relationship, but in a lot of fans' memories. And that's the power of soap operas.
Soap operas, what they do well are these type of stories about issues.
The soaps got their storylines ripped from the headlines.
Erica had one of the first abortions on television.
If you don't put up things that are a reflection of what is going on in society, there's not going to be any forward momentum.
I'm gay. I need you to understand that, Dad.
The story of soaps.
We're going to talk right now with a woman who knows what's hot and what's not on the soap opera scene. Meredith Berlin is the editor of Soap Opera Digest. Fans really do take this stuff seriously.
They do.
Why do you think people get so hooked on them? What's the appeal?
Romance, love. They talk about intimate things that you might not even talk about with your closest friend.
I am onto your game, Erica, because I already know that you have been on the pill.
The most compelling thing about daytime drama is that we follow the pulse of what's going on.
Soaps have tried to tackle the more serious topics of the day.
They will trivialize an important and serious topic much less than prime time will, because they have more time to explore it.
Because the studios were still largely run by men, daytime drama was left to its own devices and sort of decided to make the most out of that. Daytime drama went on to be the place where taboos were broken and subjects were broached and things were tackled long before primetime got around to it.
If you make a one-dimensional show, you get a one-dimensional audience and you get a one-dimensional response.
The soaps are somehow the town square. They're like where people can come to have a discussion about what is going on.
We would read these scripts and then read the newspapers and then realize, wait, this is the story we are doing right now.
Erica had one of the first abortions on television. People were not talking about these issues. They were cutting edge issues.
They were groundbreaking. It was taking this medium that could be silly, but really saying we can make a difference. We can change people's lives.
I'm gay. I need you to understand that, Dad.
For me, someone who was deeply closeted, Billy Douglas coming out as gay, was something that was direct, it was upfront.
And it hurts so much to go on lying to you, to my friends.
If I hadn't seen a story like that, I don't know how long it would have taken me to come into my own.
It was a breakthrough time. The ratings were so high because so many people were watching, they could reach people who didn't necessarily agree with them.
Telling those stories to housewives or to the women that were raising kids or running their family, I mean, those are the influencers. Those are the people who are having the tough conversations with their kids every day.
People like my brother think I decided one day, you know what, I'm over being a boy. I think I'd rather be a girl. It's not about that.
I've been doing General Hospital 25 years, been diagnosed with bipolar for 30 years. About a year and a half into the gig, they said, is it all right if we make your character bipolar? I can't thank, you know, them enough at all. Whenever I do something on mental illness, there's always someone that comes up and says, my sister, my brother, they live with bipolar, and it makes me just keep going.
Here are these people that we already know.
What does that mean?
That we already care about. If compassion came from that, then that's an amazing thing.
Billy, you are not alone.
It wasn't your fault, Nikki. It was a sickness.
Bianca, this breaks my heart.
I'm walking uphill, both ways it hurts. I'll bury my heart
face this. Can you honestly say this is sexy?
Am I going to survive this?
If you don't put up things that are a reflection of what is going on in society, there's not going to be any forward momentum.
Generations was the first fully integrated soap opera where there was an African-American storyline that was featured just as much as the white storyline. It changed perceptions. I just know that I was happy to see us not be like the maid or the best friend, to see us as professionals and having a love life.
Popularity of soaps is because there was always someone you could identify with.
I've been diagnosed with breast cancer.
All the things that the character Vicky went through.
Oh my God.
The mail that I got during the breast cancer story.
A lot of women went out and said that storyline saved their lives.
The subjects that they were hitting and talking about were very real and were happening.
If you or someone you know would like more information on treating eating disorders, please contact the National Institute of Mental Health.
By showing it on television and making it seem very acceptable, that changed the conversation.
Help me to be strong, like you are.
It's like I've been holding my breath all of my life.
You need to share this with people that you love. It's too much for you to carry alone.
You know I know what it's like to be abandoned.
Look at me. I'm alive. And I intend to be for a very long time.
The clothes were delicious. Everything. The drama of it. You couldn't believe what these people would do to each other, and yet you secretly kind of loved it.
Thou shalt not commit adultery. Soaps. Thou shalt not kill. Soaps.
The O.J. trial was a better soap opera than anybody could ever write.
How do you plead to counts one and two?
The story of soaps.
Strong, intelligent women are the future of business in our country.
You seem so sure about that.
No, I am. We're better designed to run things than men are. Men have these dreadful misconceptions about us.
Some women have always worked outside the home, but these days their number is growing by leaps and bounds.
Gone are the days where you think, oh, well, the housewife is folding laundry and watching her stories.
All of a sudden, with Title IX, women had jobs, and they could go to school, and they could do sports. And so there were not women at the home anymore. You know, which is the good news, as far as I'm concerned, for women.
Our largest base of audience was no longer home to watch the show when it was on the air. So we had the advent of the home recording devices.
Transformers and Cabbage Patch Dolls may be the two top toy sellers this year, but for adults, there's only one hot item, the VCR.
Home video has become the drug of the 80s. It's the new drug of the 80s.
Home video. It's sweeping America.
Take a cassette, slip it in the machine, set the timer, and you can record whatever program you want to watch and watch it at your convenience, not the TV station's convenience.
It's called freedom.
True.
It was now a new normal because people had broken the routine.
Obviously, people still watch the shows. The sponsors didn't like it too much because they zipped through the commercials. There was no way to measure it, so a lot of shows went off the air because their numbers didn't measure up to what they wanted them to be.
That was really a big blow to daytime television.
Soap opera. If you don't watch one at least once a week, you're now a member of one of America's newest minorities. And if you can't get off during the day, don't worry. More and more soaps are appearing at night.
Kristen, with your mind and your body, it just might take me a lifetime to figure you out.
JR, you just pushed all the right buttons.
If you want to talk about soaps being a reflection of the culture that they're in, I think there's no better example than the primetime soaps of the 1980s.
Why don't we say that soaps are better than they ever have been? I think the soaps themselves have grown up.
As you think of the me generation, the excess of the 80s, and instantly you're thinking of the sequins and the shoulder pads and the jets and the yachts.
When the networks were the only game in town, they could make whatever they wanted, and they did. They took a lot of big swings back in the 80s.
The Reagans were in the White House. Suddenly it was cool to be rich again. It was about people wearing great gowns, and it was the drama of these rich people who had incredible power. And it was such a different way into storytelling than, say, what Agnes Nixon had done, where it was about, you know, everyday struggles. Well, good heavens, Dallas, every week someone was desperately trying for control of Ewing Oil.
Dallas was the front runner. Everything else followed Dallas. Dallas was the first nighttime soap. It fulfilled a need that nobody knew was out there, and everybody wanted it.
What made nighttime soaps popular was that men and women were watching them.
I used to be asked why I thought Dallas was such a big hit. I always give them a different answer, but the one that I liked best was people like to see people that rich, that miserable.
Take this junk and your blonde tramp and get out of my home.
You are insane.
With the prime times, you'd have to wait a week, but they would always leave you with, you know, who's going to get slapped next week.
I didn't thank you for your present.
They needed glamour. They needed sex. They needed a hot-looking woman and a hot-looking guy. It's money, sex, power.
You know, all of us have some bad stuff inside. It's like, boy, I would love to do that. I would love to be a bitch and go in and just, you know, beat the hell out of JR and be nasty and come home. I get all my frustrations out.
Oh, you're crazy.
Soaps really began the practice of having a show led by a villain.
People seemed to say that they hated Abby, but they loved hating her. They knew she was doing naughty things, and they still liked her.
One of the greatest examples of this, of course, is the character of Erica Kane.
Don't you ever get tired of getting my leftovers?
I mean, she is the ultimate love to hate her villain. Frankly, the creation of her enabled J.R. Ewing in prime time, the ultimate bad guy you loved to hate.
Let's not kid ourselves. Bad guys finish first, don't they?
When I play that kind of character, I want to give it everything I can. So when the hero kills me or thwarts me in the end, it's more satisfying for the audience. You really want that guy to get it.
The story editor, Dal, said, why don't we just shoot the son of a bitch?
Who shot J.R. Frenzy was front page news. The most watched TV episode ever. 350 million people worldwide.
It was on the cover of every magazine, and it was a big deal. It was a really big deal.
People wanted more.
There's even this Who Shot J.R. poll. People's asking everybody to vote.
And Americans aren't the only ones crazed by the Dallas syndrome. Tonight, when the culprit is fingered, Air France pilots will alert passengers over the Atlantic.
We were presented to the Queen Mother, and she says, I don't suppose you could tell me who shot J.R.? I said, no, ma'am, not even you.
It was a big deal to a lot of people.
Who did shoot J.R.?
Who shot this man? Nobody seems to know.
The campaign just went on and on and on, and they milked it.
Who shot J.R. was a phenomenon.
Who shot J.R.?
Who shot J.R.?
Who shot J.R.?
I don't even know who shot him. Who shot him, by the way?
I shot J.R. I just thought that was great, great storytelling across the board.
I think it's what soaps do best. They keep you coming back. The relationships with everyone and the little bit of catfighting and their big mansions and the glamorous outfits. That's part of the appeal and what people like about the Real Housewives franchise. It's like a modern day of Dynasty or Dallas. It keeps people hooked and want to keep watching. It's
become a sort of addiction, drug, something that I can't do without.
I'm sorry, I can't marry you.
I really don't want to talk about it.
The goals of reality TV and soap operas are pretty similar. It's to educate sometimes, entertain always.
Season 3 of The Real World, we knew we had to deal with the AIDS crisis.
Now no one in America can say they've never known someone who's living with AIDS.
story of soaps.
Greetings, this is Soapline and I'm Colette Wilson. Soapline will be here for you throughout the O.J. Simpson trial, keeping you up to date on how ABC News coverage will affect your show.
O.J. came up and it kind of just destroyed everything as far as soap operas.
This is a special report from ABC News.
I'm Peter Jennings at ABC News headquarters. Let's immediately go to a picture in Los Angeles so that the rest of you around the country can see this quite extraordinary scene unfold. Police believe they have located O.J. Simpson, wanted on two counts of murder.
I remember the white Bronco. Suddenly we're watching this larger-than-life human being become something extraordinarily different.
The world went, wait a minute, this is real. This is real drama, and all eyes went to that.
In the 7 months since he led police on a bizarre slow-motion chase watched by millions of TV viewers, he's become one of the most famous murder defendants of all time.
It was hard to compete with that daytime drama, if not impossible.
Remember, in daytime, there's no hiatus, no reruns. You have 52 weeks of 5 shows a week.
For the viewers of daytime drama, it's very much a daily part of your life. So when O.J. came around and it was preempted, not only did the chain get broken in terms of people not having their shows to watch anymore, but there was no greater soap opera in the world than O.J.
Tomorrow, O.J. Simpson finally goes on trial in a case that's become a national obsession.
It had O.J., who was himself a very charismatic, compelling figure. It had the victim, Nicole Brown Simpson, the beautiful blonde. It had Kato Kaelin, Robert Kardashian. It had a lot of fascinating characters. Television really took notice of the O.J. ratings. And that's when soap opera lost its heat.
How do you plead to counts 1 and 2?
Absolutely, 100% not guilty.
We're preempted a few days, then weeks, and then months. There's no idea that something like this could happen to daytime television.
All of a sudden, they started to watch a soap opera in the trial itself. That was a better soap opera than anybody.
What people were watching was the birth of reality television.
As the trial comes to a close, it has become increasingly chaotic, with the defense refusing to rest without a suitably dramatic flourish.
It was the competition. Unfortunately, O.J. had a better show than we did.
We, just like the rest of the country, are waiting to hear it live for the very first time.
Are you nervous?
Yes. How
are
you nervous? Yes, I know.
Who's nervous? Is anybody nervous? Yeah.
We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant Orenthal James Simpson not guilty of the crime of murder in violation of a felony upon Nicole Brown Simpson, a human being, as charged in count 1 of the information.
To the country saw this verdict as you saw it, and the jury has spoken.
After the O.J. Simpson trial, suddenly people had an appetite for reality and dramatic reality.
I did not have sexual relations with that woman.
Don't treat me like a criminal, because I am innocent.
The closeness was emphasized when the so-called Camillagate tape leaked out.
What O.J. showed the world was that, frankly, when it's real, it's just more interesting.
This murder case created a media frenzy that sustained itself fully for a decade.
Once you're telling the people who are watching soaps, wait, watch this, this is compelling,
it was pretty easy to get sucked into that. And then you're starting to consider Court TV or CNN as a viable alternative to All My Children or One Life to Live.
People couldn't get enough of that stuff that happened in real life when it's like stranger than fiction. You can't make it up. This actually really happened. This 24 cycle of news has taken over our lives, and we've gotten addicted to it.
They've programmed their shows like daytime programs or shows, where you're making news serialized so that it gives you reason to come back to see it in the next hour or the next day, and you get addicted. How many news junkies are there out now? The same ones who used to be addicted to soap operas.
The story of soaps.
Make sure I ask Erica about that rapper getting killed at Teddy's rental.
Well, we're voyeurs, but we also love stories, you know? We want to be entertained.
She said you can suck a bottle, but you can't.
And I think that the ultimate expression of voyeurism is reality television.
Which is the top of your hand, which is the bottom?
I know Lucci doesn't agree with me, but I think that the housewives have replaced soap operas because, you know, truth is stranger than fiction.
If you're wondering what stopped the world from turning, might be right here.
Truth is stranger than fiction. I think that's why a lot of mainstream television shows, scripted shows don't work, and a lot of reality shows do, because you can't believe this is actually happening.
Soaps became kind of unnecessary because you could do it with real people, and they're writing the drama themselves.
You don't sing, you don't dance, you don't have any, forgive me, any talent.
But we're still entertaining people.
Well, I think reality shows have taken over because they're cheaper.
Jen?
You're dancing with another girl!
And easier to produce.
What are you looking for in a woman?
Ethnicity, race, physical appearance.
But they also have the same kind of characteristics that the soaps have. God knows we threw glasses in daytime.
Oh. And you are not gonna mess it up.
You! I hate you!
I am from Chicago.
This just feels really schemy and slimy to me.
When you consider a lot of the things that have been labeled outrageous, absurd, and inconceivable on daytime soaps.
Children should be with their mothers. Not with murdering psychopath mothers. No, they shouldn't.
Plot twists like, I was about to divorce my husband, was getting ready to sign the papers, and then he collapsed in a near-death experience, and I'm the only person who has the ability to make decisions for him while he's in a coma. That was Chloe and Lamar. That actually happened.
I guess if you become deeply involved in someone else's drama, your drama doesn't feel so bad.
It didn't take long for reality to become part of the popular conversation. And it was like the real world really kicked it all off.
This is the true story. True story.
Of seven strangers picked to live in a loft
and have their lives taped
to find out what happens.
What?
When people stop being polite
and start getting real.
Start being real.
And yes, I know that by heart.
The real world.
I don't think reality TV would be here without Mary Ellis Bunim. Mary Ellis was like the queen of daytime soaps. She had executive produced a number of them. When I got together with her to create The Real World, the year was 1991, and the thought process was driven by desperation. I mean, we were having a tough time.
These are trying times for television executives. So many competing channels, so much pressure to put on shows that'll attract a large enough audience to keep the advertising revenue up.
When we talked to MTV about The Real World, We basically pitched it as a docu-soap.
At least try to understand where I'm coming from.
How can you expect me to?
The soap opera tropes attach almost instantly. There was always a gorgeous single guy and a gorgeous single girl. What do you know? They're in the same house.
Ow! Ow, ow, ow!
We took so much of what had been learned in daytime storytelling and applied it to these real stories.
MTV's The Real World, San Francisco.
Season 3 of The Real World, it was 1994, and if we were going to be in San Francisco in 1994, we knew we had to deal with the AIDS crisis.
Your total helper's T cells are 32 right now. So that's a drop for you.
Pedro Zamora was an AIDS educator who had found out in his high school blood drive that he was HIV positive.
Pedro came around at the height of AIDS panic in the country. People were panicked to get it. There was so much misinformation about people who had AIDS.
I did not get AIDS because I am gay. I got it because I had unprotected sex.
I can't underestimate the importance of Pedro Zamora on The Real World.
He was doing everything he could to awaken other young people to the danger of AIDS and the importance of practicing safe sex.
If you are gonna have sex, then you need to protect yourself. Here's a condom.
I think what we learned from Pedro is that reality television could take big swings and teach millions of people something.
A good character, whether it's a scripted character in soap or a reality character, there has to be a vulnerability to them. There has to be something that people latch onto, you know, where they want to take this journey.
The great advantage of telling a story in a soap opera is that you can show so many dimensions of what you're trying to represent and show it through characters that the audience really already knows and loves.
Dan. Why do you keep saying that?
Because. I'm HIV positive.
HIV becoming AIDS on General Hospital. A lot of people receive their education there. It's different from when you were just reading things in the paper or, you know, listening to a headline on the news for folks that you didn't know anything about. We definitely already loved Stone and Robin.
In that case, it was stolen from the emotional headlines.
I want whatever time we have. And I know in my heart that it's going to be longer than anybody else thinks.
These were intimate shows, and soaps were extraordinary at touching those issues because they could actually develop them.
This has progressed to advanced AIDS.
The story was phenomenal. It dealt with fear and it dealt with misunderstandings and it dealt with a society not ready to embrace what we have and how we can move forward as a society and make things better and in the world make things better. General Hospital was an amazing platform for that story.
The goals of reality TV and soap operas are pretty similar. Reality television draws its inspiration from scripted shows, but when you think about it, scripted shows draw their inspiration from reality.
After 5 years of fighting misconceptions about AIDS, Pedro Zamora died early this morning.
I promise to never leave you and stay by your side as long as you let me.
Over the past few years, Pedro became a member of all of our families. Now, no one in America can say they've never known someone who's living with AIDS.
This is the face of HIV. It's not so horrible, is it? It's not so scary.
It seems less crucial to tune in to General Hospital when you're also binge-watching Orange is the New Black and you're also keeping up on five or six other shows that you're obsessed with. There's enough ways to get your serialized drama fix.
The story of soaps.
When I started about a quarter of a century ago, there were 13 daytime dramas. There are now 4.
News 10 at 5.
I want my soaps! Save our soaps! This is about more than television shows!
ABC Network announced earlier this month that it is canceling All My Children and One Life to Live.
Guiding Light first hit the airwaves when Franklin Roosevelt was president. Today, it became a victim of changing times.
This is some sad news. The company that coined the phrase soap opera 76 years ago says it's canceling As the World Turns after a 54-year run.
Soaps used to be a huge cash cow for the networks, and now they almost cost more to make than they do to bring it.
Oh, gosh. I think people were horrified.
Save our soaps! Save our soaps!
One Life to Live is under budget. It's coming with a profit. It's better than General Hospital. It's number 3 in the ratings. Yet they're canceling it for a show called The Chew After The View and The Revolution.
I wasn't surprised by the reaction because, I mean, no one's more passionate than soap fans.
What do we want? When do we want it?
It's a shame. It's taking away from people something that they were so invested in.
When One Life to Live got canceled, it was shot to the heart.
I grew up on All My Children. I mean, I grew up as a person on All My Children. I worked there. I grew up watching One Life to Live. So it was a very sad day for me.
It's a loss. It's a loss of a daytime culture, and it's a loss of a family ritual.
They were shows that mothers watched with their daughters, that daughters would watch with their daughters.
Not only am I a fan of soaps, I was named after a soap character. Erica King. So, yes, soaps were big in my house.
I'm still angry they took it off the air. Still angry. Because Susan Lucci rocks. She still rocks.
Who am I? I am Erica Kane.
When All My Children was taken off the air, the fans, they are like soccer fans. If you called ABC, the recording would say, if you are calling to express your upset at All My Children being canceled, press 1. For all other ABC business, press 2. And they crashed the computer system and the phone system at All My Children.
It was a very sad day. The ones that are on the air continue to produce the show for virtually no money.
I do.
No, you don't.
Who's that?
You sound drunk.
Do you know how to say vodka in Spanish?
Who wants more wine?
Oh, good Lord, no. I'll have to sleep here.
Ooh, we would love that. That's not easy. That's good writing.
There is nothing wrong with a medical professional needing psychiatric counseling.
Oh, no. Please, I'm not a patient. Come on.
I mean, honestly, the challenge now is to write something for a soap that you're not going to see on the news, because you can't really trump that.
A woman who made headlines in 1996 for allegedly plotting to kill her twin sister.
Pilots in two different planes are reported seeing a mysterious object.
So if Tracy is proven to be their father, it means that this husband and wife are also brother and sister.
Unfortunately, we're living in a soap opera, and it's we can't change the channel. So it's a little different in terms of what we might need now to feel better about the world or ourselves or our lives. It's a little different.
The race for the living room is on, and it includes more content than you could watch in a lifetime.
Now, the audience, which is so fractured, can watch on streaming, on network. In fact, today, in primetime, shows that are considered hits wouldn't necessarily have the ratings that would have sustained them years ago.
It's sadly not an industry where too many young people are coming in, because there's new media that they're getting into.
And the constraints that daytime had in budget, in time, and execution, it's not possible to have daytime thrive again. Not in that current way of production. It's just not possible.
And finally, primetime seemed to have co-opted our genre. Game of Thrones is nothing if not a soap opera.
And therefore, people started to get their fix elsewhere.
Everybody wants
a soap. They want a soap template. You know, they want to have bingeable shows. They want cliffhangers.
Medical shows, police shows, you name it, it's all a soap opera.
The story of soaps.
Interesting story about Desperate. I think 5 or 6 networks passed on the pilot script of Desperate Housewives. And I couldn't believe no one wanted to do it. My feelings were hurt. I knew it was the best thing I'd ever written.
You were a virgin?
Didn't show?
No.
Want me to keep my dream clothes on like last time?
If you would.
And then I had this wonderful thing happen where my agent was arrested for embezzlement. So I had to get a new agent. And the new agent said, I don't understand why this script hasn't sold. And I said, well, I was pitching it to the networks, you know, as a black comedy. Well, that's why no one wants to do it. You've got to call it a soap opera, but one that's got comedy in it. And I went, oh, okay.
I'm okay with me. I can walk down the street and hold my head high.
When Desperate Housewives premiered, there were a lot of interviews talking about, has television gone too far? And I always thought, no, we're not. Everything we've done on my show, Agnes Nixon has already done. We're just doing it in prime time. Because ABC did not develop it internally, it was a spec script that was bought. They started taking a chance on more writers who had their own visions, their own ideas, things that they had developed by themselves, and networks started buying those scripts. Networks were realizing, hey, let's trust the writers. They'll take us into places that we don't know we want to go. All of this has an effect on the creativity of writers. You know, writers now, the sky's the limit with what you can walk into a network and do.
You kept that secret for 36 years.
When people think about soaps, they think about daytime. That's not the whole story, it's just part of it.
Soap operas laid the groundwork for the huge swell of amazing primetime television that we have right now, and I'm including all the streaming content. Mad Men, The Sopranos, The Wire. Soap opera plus Western equals Breaking Bad.
I love not knowing where it's going. I love the fact that this stuff is changing and we don't know what's gonna happen. Anything can happen.
Today, my mommy and me are doing a giant Easter egg hunt.
Now using a purple liquid lipstick, I am creating...
Come on, bro.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to my channel.
What is television anymore? Is Netflix television? Is Hulu television? Is YouTube television? Is Facebook television?
Let's go, baby! First up, he's flossing!
I think storytelling is storytelling. I think we have a lot of different ways to experience it. I think podcasts are one.
This is a Global CalLink prepaid call from...
Adnan Sayed.
The thing that's funny is that new generations go, this is the greatest new thing that is like, actually, it's been, that was the first thing. That's before television was even invented.
Drop that gun, use control.
But the difference is, it's on demand, it's when you want it and where you want it.
And now they're taking those serialized podcasts and making them into television shows. So it's recyclable.
And you have to get rid of more than half of these no-good cops on your payroll.
My daughter has been kidnapped.
Good drama is good drama. And whether it's on stage, on the page, at primetime, late night, daytime, it all boils down to good drama.
The story of soaps.
People want to get back to escapism, I think. I mean, discord is at an all-time high right now, and decency at an all-time low. And people don't know where to turn to. So to lock into a different place, different characters, and sort of escape into their world and their lives and out of your own for a little bit is really needed right now. So I'm glad the soaps are still around for us to jump into and escape.
I love you so much.
I got wind beneath my wings.
What would I do without you, huh?
Time I'm gonna make it tomorrow.
I have let you into places I didn't even know I had.
I got strength within my heart.
The fact that soaps have still had a solid foothold in entertainment, that's kind of remarkable.
The implicit question was, are soap operas going to survive? The answer is definitively yes.
The magic of daytime is being in someone's home every single day.
It was kind of the original binge watch. You knew that the next day there was going to be another one. You didn't have to wait another week. So I think that's the real hook.
You are doubting my word?
I'm doubting your motives.
It's me! There's something wrong with me!
I just hope that when you're his age, you're half the man your father is.
You gotta see people that look like you, that may have a perspective like you do, and if it's not seen, then TV's not doing its job.
Ultimately, we are an industry that functions best as a mirror to the society we are depicting. And when society changes, we must change along with it.
Years ago, we were the damsel in distress or mom at home with the kids cooking, and now that's changed. You're seeing women running companies. Oh my gosh, we're role models now.
I think I got his attention.
The story of soaps is people you love who always show up for you.
The story of soaps is about family.
I loved being your father.
I would do anything for you.
It's all about creating an emotional connection. If you don't love the character or love to hate the character, you're not going to watch it. You're not going to be addicted to it, because what you're creating in an emotional connection is not only do you make a must-see, you make a need-to-see.
The streak is over, Susan Lucas!
Soap operas deserve so much respect, honor, and love only because of what soap operas give audiences. There's a reason that this genre has lasted so long, and there's a reason why it has transmuted into so many new genres and been so influential. We just can't afford as a culture to not understand them and to not respect them.
The story of soaps is essentially the story of us. It's who we are, what we're doing, where we're going, what we're afraid of, what we long for, the things that happen that are pretty scary and tough, and the things that are happening that are full of joy. It's us.
I always knew what you were, and I always knew what you wanted.
I'm a mother.
Yes, we're going.
I missed you.
Hello.
Thank you very much.
Hi.
Really, what I should have done is had a margarita before I got here.
Okay. Very funny.
You said...
Go ahead. I'm going to look right in that lens, the big camera.
All right. Here we go.
Oh.
No, I love that.
Yeah?